I wanted to begin by asking Scott, are you blown away by the Hudson Yards success? And what do you attribute it to?
So I just want to comment first on the setup here, so everyone has a sense. So Marianne wouldn't allow us to rehearse or talk about what questions that we were going to discuss because she wanted us to be natural. So of course she puts me in treacherous territory right away with Hudson Yards, and I've had this experience before because I don't remember how many years ago it was, but I was on a panel and I made a comment how I thought Hudson Yards wouldn't work. And of course, as I was leaving that panel, Bruce Beal, one of the partners with Steve and Jeff, grabbed me and berated me and then called everyone that knew both of mutual friends to berate me. and then, of course, I was fortunate enough that Steve and Jeff invited me for their inaugural lunch at Nilo's at Hudson Yards. And Bruce called to tell me, you know, I was wrong, and I admitted I was wrong. And so it shows you what I originally thought, right? Which was,
right,
how could this work? It's such a massive project. And I think it's a few things. One, I think it's a good testament to good public-private partnerships where a good structure was put in place to bring transportation, to create the right incentives, to be able to put the infrastructure in place to build that. The second thing, I think you got to give the related guys a tremendous amount of credit. I'm not sure there's any other developer that could have done what they did. And a few things they did. First, they were bold, right? They realized to ultimately do this, you couldn't build one building at a time. You had to build a destination. You had to build, reinvent, and reimagine a community of what wasn't there. And I think that to do that with no, you know, history as to what's going to happen is pretty bold to do. It's the second thing was the way they marketed it, right? They incented the big companies to come there, telling them they're going to do this at their cost. So they were able to get these big anchor tenants at their cost. We'll do an audit one day and find out if it was, but it worked and it brought the big names to come. And they also gave people the opportunity to imagine what it could be. And one thing I've learned in real estate on our side, it's much harder to take an existing building that you're redeveloping and get the user to forget what it looks like today and reimagine what it's going to look like in the future. And it's much easier if you're starting with nothing and a blank piece of paper and be able to get the imagination going.
Can I tell you, that issue of having to deal with the history has haunted me with the World Trade Center. Because in many ways, the reason, again, that the Yards fascinates me so is I compare and contrast with the Trade Center all the time. And on one hand, you have a place that's just steeped in history downtown. I mean, everybody has a vision of what downtown means. They may not have been there in 10 years, and by the way, most people haven't. But they have it fixed in their head. And one of the things that happens all the time at the Trade Center is people come down and they're like, wow, when did all this happen? Right. And you're like, where have you been that you're just noticing it? At the Yards, I always think a couple of things really were totally influential. It, as you say, tabula rasa, right? No story, no nothing, a rail cut. But Related had this long history of knowing how to market residential and retail. And let's be honest, those of us in the commercial office sector, we don't know nothing about marketing. We're still talking about the dollar a square foot budget, right? The first time I walked into the Yards marketing suite, I actually was there with Steve Ross, and I was like, oh my God. And he said, I spent $25 million on this. And again, the scale of the project warranted, but that vision to understand that you bring in David Rockwell, you make something so remarkable that people just felt like they were buying into something magical. And I think the other thing, you said it, and I'm going to make the real deal part of the story here. I think for years, every day, the real deal had a story about Hudson Yards. I have to say, and not just the real deal, but the real deal was certainly there. And I kept thinking Joanna Rose, who heads PR and marketing for Related, she must get up in the morning and think, oh, we need a story on the sidewalks of Hudson Yards. And you'd have these crazy stories that made, frankly, to me, no commercial sense at all. But it was in your brain.
Right.
You actually believed in something that didn't even exist.
Well, you used the word magical. And when I toured the sales office, it reminded me of going to Walt Disney. Like, it was like an experience.
Yes.
You felt like you already experienced what it was going to be by the way they created that. But just to pivot, you mentioned the World Trade Center. And we worked together in the World Trade Center when I was vice chair of the Port Authority, collaboratively most of the time. So you yelled at me every now and then, but it was relatively good. But you were there early, and when you brought Connie Nast downtown. And I know there was always a lot of criticism for the amount of money that the public invested in One World Trade, in the subsidies for Connie Nast. And now that we reflect back on it, do you think the World Trade Center would be the World Trade Center if it wasn't for taking the risk of bringing someone like Connie downtown?
So it's the Trade Center is such an interesting case study in comparison to the arts, because think of the press. The Trade Center has been in the press now since 9/11. And first we had obviously the post 9/11 press. Then we had the enormous political battle about what was going to be built there. And then from the moment it began, it was the daily dysfunction of competing interests arguing with each other. The beauty of what happened with Condi, and by the way, I always say about a tribute to Cy Newhouse. I was thinking about him a lot lately because this week Christie's is selling part of his great art collection. And he was always a man who had such a clear vision of the future. But the other thing he had was he wasn't afraid. It was a private company. He had a clear understanding of the economics. He wanted to leave the company with. He understood the challenges that print journalism was going to have in years to come. And what we had the good fortune with is that we had Chris Ward, who was then running the PA, and we had a board that was there to help us. So without Condi, I'm not sure what would have happened. I don't know if you remember, there was a preceding deal with a Chinese company that was going to take three floors at Tower One.
Vantone or something like that?
Yes, Vantone.
Vantone.
Exactly. And that evaporated basically in time. So that really helped. I do want to say to you, though, without you, and I'm saying this in front of everybody, there was no three World Trade Center. Because I want to be very clear, every one of the buildings has been a battle. I mean, it's the craziest thing, right? And I don't know if any of you remember this, but there was a Port Authority, I'm just going to name him. There was a Port Authority board member, Ken Lipper, who believed that he had the insight into the fact that New York didn't need any new office buildings. And I was thinking of Larry sitting here, by the way, saying how amazing New York is, absorbing the yards, absorbing Manhattan West, absorbing the Spiral, absorbing the Trade Center. And Ken Lipper went around to every newspaper and had editorials from the New York Times, everybody, not the Post, I might add, but everybody gave him an editorial saying, Ken is right, it shouldn't be built. And Scott led the way, because no sooner did Scott back us than Group M came along for the anchor 700,000. And I just want to point out that, you know, McKinsey came, Diageo came. We are leasing steadily. I mean, at this point, we probably have six or seven deals in process. I'm hopeful that maybe by the end of the year, we'll finish three. But without your advocacy. But you know what that goes back to? Having somebody who deeply understood real estate finance on the board, but also understood how to deal with the board members. I mean, I don't know how you persuaded them.
Yeah, well, you know, and by the way, Spotify went down there subsequently, right, to endorse it. But it was a tough battle that we experienced together through the process and had to navigate the politics. But it's interesting to bring it to current times and just thinking about a public-private partnership that worked to one that didn't, and thinking about Amazon, right? And I think about that a lot relative to the changing dynamic where, the community really just, you know, in terms of turning on Amazon and the lack of leadership of so many of the players involved on stewarding Amazon through. And you watch what has happened now with the Trade Center and all of the the secondary effects of how it brought alive all of Lower Manhattan in so many different ways,
right,
and what an Amazon in Long Island City could have done for that entire community, right? And how it, and even forget even this, the whatever they committed to do or whatever subsidies they were going to get. If someone was going to make this their headquarters and invest this much money into a neighborhood, they're going to make sure the quality of life in that neighborhood is good. They're going to make sure that crime is low. They're going to make sure that people are investing in the public housing, that people have jobs, because otherwise they have made a bad investment for their employees to work there, right? So it's just a sad state. And it's an interesting comparison of when you look, think about what works and what hasn't worked. But it also speaks on the other side of the coin of how strong, in my opinion, the New York City market is. And, you know, we've had this conversation for a long time about in an idea-based economy where talent is the most important ingredient, New York is the magnet for that talent from around the world. And I've been an advocate for that, but I've even been shocked at how strong and resilient the New York City job market has been and attracting these companies to continue to make investments here like they have. And I just even recently, I was with a big CEO of a large Silicon Valley company who's here hiring 1,000 people because they can't hire those people in San Francisco, or Spotify expanding here because they can't hire in Europe. And so, you know, in your history with New York, have you ever experienced it as healthy as it is right now?
No, and it sort of defies logic. I mean, we'll come to that, I'm sure, because the city, and to a certain extent the state, but the city for sure, is doing everything it can to make it hard to operate in the city, whether it's the individuals you have to attract and what you have to pay them, or the rules and regs that cover everything. But I say all of that, and then you ask a company, why? Why did you choose this? Spotify to me is such an interesting example. If you speak to Barry McCarthy, the CFO, why here? Just to your point, because we can get the talent here. I also asked, by the way, this was so interesting for me, why the Trade Center? And, you know, this whole dynamic, everybody associates tech companies with, you know, you're a Starrett Lehigh owner, and boy, has that building been an enormous success. But there aren't that many truly large scale, pre-World War II buildings, industrial in character. In fact, most of them are pretty small by comparison. And as a consequence, if you need a scalable place, you have a hard time finding that in a Midtown South location where the average business building size is probably 250 to 300. But going back to Spotify, they needed to think about scale. But the other thing he told me is the connectivity to Newark Airport. And the fact that they fly to Sweden all the time, which is where Spotify's headquartered, and all the Swedish airlines are at Newark. I'm like, oh, I wish we'd known that when we were negotiating. I mean, it's such an interesting thing, and you know this deeply from your involvement with transit. I mean, you have the transit connections. Transit connection, it's talent first. I think transit connections second.
Yeah, no, it's interesting. And by the way, I toured the CFO of Spotify to Starrett Lehigh, and they were a tenant of ours at 620.
Yeah.
And I was sure that they would move to Starrett Lehigh, and I was shocked when they went to the Four World Trade, but I now...
And you saw how many additional... I mean, one of my favorite things is Hudson River Trading, a great hedge fund, quantitative hedge fund, opens up there. They build brilliant space, Gensler designed, and Spotify comes along and says, we need the space. And we're like, what? These people just built their space. I don't want to even discuss the cost. And Hudson River Trading says, you know, we'd actually like to move to 3 because we need to double our space. And Spotify just ate it up and, as you know, took some of the Port Authority space too.
Right. No, but it shows you the strength of the market. The other thing I think is interesting dynamic, and it ties to this, is it used to be that this market was about submarkets, Midtown, Downtown, you know, the West Side. And now it's so much more about the buildings themselves. I mean, you have your point, public transportation, critical, right? You get a premium for that. New buildings, people are willing to do for the efficiencies and the benefits of being in a new building. But, you know, the third, which I would say, is this concept of character and community, right? And that it's a building that has character and community also demands a premium because talent wants to work there. And, you know, my sort of take on this has been that, you know, where people used to work 9 to 5 and now they work 5 to 9, and there's a merger of home life and work life, And the glue that brings that together is that sense of community. And that activating buildings to provide that sense of community is a critical differentiator, particularly if you have some of those pre-war buildings that have the character to them that are really well located, but have to compete with new buildings today. And you know, Starrett Lehigh is an example. As you know, the rents were $30, now we're doing $60 to $70 a foot. I attribute a lot of that to the community building that we were able to create within the building itself, not just the building itself.
So you've just given me this the setup to ask you what I'm sure everybody wants to ask you about 75 Rock. How do you have Convene, WeWork, and Airbnb in the same building, and why?
So, actually, Marianne used a word with me. She said, what kind of cocktail are you making there? And she's shaking it up. And I think that's
right.
I thought that was a clever way to say it. So again, you know, for us, you know, going back to that community building, I think real estate's changed. And more generally, right, the world has become much more disrupted by technology. And of the different groups, just like on marketing, to your point, our industry has been the last to adapt and the last to be affected. Maybe in the retail world it has been, but office in general and multifamily, very little in terms of technology. And I think that's changing because I think our customers' expectations as to what they want are changing, right? When they're not in our buildings, they're getting customized, personalized, bespoke service. You know, they have Alexa telling them your coffee's running out, time to order more. Their iPhone telling them where to go and how long it's going to take them to get there. And we haven't done that. And so I think from a real estate standpoint, our view is to really do your job to service your customer. It just can't be about building the four walls and signing a long-term lease. It's got to be about activating and merchandising and programming what happens within those four walls to create a sense of energy, to create that sense of community. Mm-hmm. And it's hard to do that if you have a building that generally is open only 5 days a week, 10 hours a day. How do you actually invest in the programming, in the amenities, in the F&B? How do you have the activity and energy in the building for the people that are working there? So by mixing the uses in a building like this, where you have traditional office, flexible office, hospitality, conference space, restaurants, and different types of clubs, you're now taking a building that was open just at 5 days a week for 10 hours to 24 hours, 7 days a week. And that gives you the ability to create a much broader community and service it and curate it with many more amenities than you otherwise would be able to have.
So one of the things that has always fascinated me about RXR and you is that financing something that is in fact as experimental. You're absolutely right, by the way. Culture trumps everything right now. By the way, that is the secret of the arts. They sold it as cool. Now, whether the reality is cool or not, I don't know.
Right.
But I would tell you that that was the sell. You go there and this is going to be such a fabulous thing for your
They call it lifestyle. They'll say
it's all lifestyle.
Right.
All lifestyle. I mean, think about the vessel, the whole, you know, whatever, the number varies all the time, but $150 million, $200 million spent so that people could have Instagrammable moments at the yards. So I ask you, actually, I'm going to even scroll backwards. I remember when you were starting RXR, and it was at a moment when everybody said the city was already priced to perfection. There was no opportunity out there. And subsequently, you've come in and become one of the major owners of the city. So you obviously have to be brilliant at the capital structure part of this. By the way, I know you were fed it at the breakfast table as a child, so you have that. But how are you able to put together the capital structure that enables you to take a gamble like 75 Rock is now?
So, you know, when we started RXR, it was right after we sold Rexon, which was January of 2007. So we had a part of a benefit, which is we sold our company at a good time and then didn't do anything until August of 2009. And so when we came back in, it was still an early point in the market cycle. And I remember, as a matter of fact, you know, we started buying debt, buying preferred, and Starrett Lehigh was our first mega acquisition. It was almost the first $1 billion or so acquisition coming out of this cycle. And I remember going to Marianne and having bringing investors to try to convince them, do you remember, institutional investors that were invested in our fund, to actually convince them why the west side of Manhattan could be something special and why this building that's not this tall glass building could work. And Marianne had brought many years ago Martha Stewart in as the first tenant was a big believer.
And I would say Martha found it herself. She called, and do you remember my saying this to you? And I said to her, Martha, how are people going to get there? And she said, I don't care. I'll drive my pickup truck into the building, and if they want to work for me, they'll get there. And boy, didn't she turn out to be absolutely right.
By the way, she's still my most demanding tenant that I have. I mean, I was on the phone with the governor a couple of years ago, and I keep seeing Martha Stewart's number keeps coming on. And I'm trying to not, like, pick up this phone, but she keeps calling, so I have to say, I'm really sorry, she's going to call you back. I pick up the phone, and Martha's secretary says, can you hold on for Martha? And she says, Scott, I know what this building's missing. I'm like, what? She says, a blow bar. And I got just the woman to do it. Sweetie, what's your name? She's getting her hair blown out, and she wants us to put one of those in Starry Lehigh. And she wasn't wrong, by the way, but I didn't need the 10 phone calls along there. But it's, to your point, so just keep going back to this, one of the reasons we sold from being a public company was we saw the world changing, and not just the valuations. We saw that our customers, the needs were changing, and that the public markets wouldn't give us the flexibility to adapt and take risks and change the way we look at our buildings and our customers that we thought we were going to need. And so when we sold, it was primarily because we wanted to bring in an investment in a capital structure that gave us the ability to lead where we thought our customers were going versus being held back from that before. So, we've raised $9 billion of private equity, mostly in discretionary funds that give us the flexibility to go experiment and take on things that would not necessarily seem to be the norm at the time that we do them. But even with that, getting financing on the debt side, you have to convince people as to why this makes sense. Even with the Pier 57 was not an easy thing to finance, even with Google as part of the tenant, because you're financing a floating 20th century pier. But we ultimately got it done. And so you build a track record, right? People begin to trust your judgment that it's going to work. You bring in good partners like Airbnb and WeWork and Convene that have a proven track record as well. And frankly, we looked at 75 Rock to this cocktail, as you call it, to be the prototype. And we're hoping it becomes the house drink.
That's great. That's perfect. Tell me why you're investing alongside TF Cornerstone in the rebuilding of the Hyatt.
So the other area where, as we talked about, where you could see tenants flocking are transportation, new construction. And so when it came to our to us with the TF Cornerstone and MSD to buy into their air rights over Grand Central and then develop a new building where the existing Hyatt Hotel is, it was compelling, A, because we got to tear down the Hyatt, which was be fun for a number of reasons, and B, because to be able to build a brand new building with a hotel right next to public transportation and have all the specs and modernization of that building. And so, and another building that has been a great example is One Vanderbilt that SL Green's done, right?
Yeah, it's done amazingly well.
It's done
not
amazingly.
Even amazingly. And by the way, I think it's beautiful.
No, beautiful. And again, maybe it's kind of strange because I'm bold in my own ideas, but I was skeptical about that as well. And can Mark and them get the rents that they wanted to achieve? And they've been incredible getting the rents, and they're almost 60% occupied. So we had the benefit also of seeing that success, which gave us the confidence that building a building of similar ilk on the other side of Grand Central will be astounding.
You know the crazy thing about Midtown East rezoning that was so obvious at the time of sort of the creation, but now I realize we read it all wrong. So what was the big discussion? The big discussion are what were the sites that were going to be developed. Everybody thought the Pfizer site was going to be the first to go, right?
Yep.
There was not a doubt in the world. And if you think about it for a little bit, you say, well, that makes perfect sense. Pfizer was getting out. You were going to be able to knock down the building, et cetera. But if I had spent any time thinking about it, at the moment the city set the floor, saying, the floor was going to be basically 312 an FAR, the only place you could build and have it make any sense is two things. One, where you could get the highest rents, and two, where you could get the greatest density. That's pretty much Park Avenue or right around Grand Central.
Yep.
And I think there's a good shot that all the air rights of Midtown East are going to end up going there, because even though you could do it on Madison, they didn't give you the density on Madison. Now, if Harry does his building on 51st, 52nd, that'll soak up some of the air rights for sure.
Right.
But a lot of that is 74, 79, the transfer across the street and not Midtown East rezoning. But it's really interesting to me, kind of the unintended consequences. Because I thought they were going to knock down, I don't know, pick a building, 711 Third. But in fact, it doesn't make a lot
right.
of sense.
Because no, you need the higher and better use. But let's take this back for a second. Because what's interesting to me is, this all ties back to Hudson Yards and the World Trade Center.
Yeah.
Because adding new product to Manhattan, which was starved for new product, created the demand for the tenants that were filling that new product. B, it forced landlords that owned really well-located buildings to have to upgrade their buildings to compete with new product, right? So we're redoing 237 Park, 75 Rock, L&L, everyone's redoing that. So it sparked a renaissance around Manhattan. And that then led to, now we add that to Midtown East zoning, then that follows through, that you need to now bring your building into the 21st century to get the highest and best use. And the rent differentiation, right, is something like 45% for Class A new after 2008 versus Class A average, right? So it makes economic sense to do that.
So I actually had occasion to ask Jamie Dimon why what's the most expensive thing they could possibly do. If there's anything I've learned in all the years I've been doing brokerage, it's always the most expensive thing is to swing out and swing back in. It sounds like simple until you actually do the numbers, and then it's impossible. So it was so interesting for me. He said it was entirely driven by Midtown East, because he said right now the building houses 7,000 people. And he said when he looked at it and asked his people, what would happen, he could have 15,000 people. And it just struck me as crazy that somebody who heads a truly global company wanted 15,000 of his people like right at hand, and that was worth whatever it was going to cost to get them all there.
And security and everything else that goes
yes.
with that, right? So
it's a big thing.
Amazing. But, you know, again, another good example in that zoning being put in place of good government. And there was an article, I think in the Times last week, that asked the question, in the current environment, would the de Blasio administration have been supported to the East Midtown zoning legislation?
So I want to say this. I want to give the mayor, things have gone awry since the zoning passed, but when he was public advocate, I met with him to talk to him about the rezoning, and I showed him basically what would happen to the tax base if we just kept on the way we were, and if in fact we could move ahead. The Bloomberg administration had, they had really done basically all the land use work. But nothing pretty much changed from Amanda Burden and Edith Suchan's work, but they had a crazy financial construct. And to the immense credit of de Blasio and Alicia Glenn, they rejiggered that and made it market-driven and much more straightforward. Basically, they just put a tax on it. So, I remember that he had committed to Cardinal Dolan that he would get it done. He said in the first year it took 4 years. What else is new? What's happened since then, though, is really scary. I don't know, I think I said this to you before. This morning I got a call from the guy, Todd Kahn, who's the president of Tapestry, which is Coach and coaches companies like Stuart Weitzman, et cetera. So we're chatting about whatever, and then he said to me, he said, by the way, I was with Mayor de Blasio yesterday discussing shearling with him and why we needed to be able to sell shearling in New York. And I thought to myself, where have we gone? That we're now trying to take whatever the most progressive values we have and force them down the throat of every consumer and drive business away in that way. I mean, you're more deeply involved in politics, certainly more intimately involved than I am. But I feel as though, you know, I always think the three stools of development in New York are financing, politics, and community. But two of them now are dominating in a way that's unbelievable.
I would say in all my years of being in this business, I've never seen a more challenging political environment. And I mean, and some of it you see nationally, where there's a lot of divisiveness that carries through, or even in the already the presidential election with the Democrats, as everyone trying to trump who's the, I guess pun intended, who's further left than the next person. And what happens is ideology is overwhelming pragmatism. And even going back to the Amazon issue, you know, we know Amazon had issues. We knew Amazon was going to create challenges to the infrastructure. We knew it was the potential to displace people. We knew it might raise the cost of housing. But when you have those types of problems, you then sit down and you try to constructively figure out solutions to those problems, not just say no. And where I think we're at right now in that this political environment is, it's just no. It's not about compromise. It's not about trying to understand the issues. It's not about trying to be pragmatic. And they're sweeping, a series of policies through that could have meaningful impacts to our business environment, our economic vitality of the region for decades to come, without any real understanding of the nuances and the circumstance around. So I'll give you just a couple of examples in Albany and the city. But in Albany right now, there's a prevailing wage bill, and it sounds good, because the reality is everyone should get paid a fair wage, and I'm a believer in everyone getting paid a fair wage. But this bill basically says that anyone that takes any dollar of public incentives needs to do 100% of that project using prevailing wage, which means union level wages and all union benefits that go with that. So to put that in real life examples, while we have this affordable housing crisis, we're looking at building a project in New Rochelle, which is a transit-oriented development. And if you bid it using part union, part non-union, taking the bids that way, you're actually, versus this prevailing wage, it's a 50% difference in cost, 5-0. So it's not like you're going to pay a little more. You're just not going to build it. And so the consequence of this bill, which is reasonable in context, is that it's going to impact another one of our big challenges, which is affordable housing. I'll say the same thing about recently city council passed a bill dealing with the carbon footprint, right? And they're putting penalties over time on commercial buildings related to their use of emissions of greenhouse gases. And what's interesting, if you think about one of the most environmentally sustainable buildings in New York City, is the Bank of America buildings that the Durst built. And that building, as a model, would end up paying meaningful penalties in 2030 based on what that legislation says.
But can I tell you, so much of this, I think, is that the people who are influencing us, whether it's the city council people, the community board people, the people in the state assembly or senate, are actually, I said to Scott earlier, I feel like we should say, field trip, let's all go to the basement of One Bryant Park. Immediately take as many city council people with us as we can to show them what that base, if you've ever never been there, I always say it's like going to the Starship Enterprise. You're like, holy cow, this is what you have to do to make a sustainable giant skyscraper. And I said, I feel as though we have a lot of people who are clear on their principles, but don't understand how they translate into reality. And that, by the way, part of what we need to do as an industry, we need to start getting our own, and I define it in the broadest sense, on community boards. A few years back, when Chris Quinn was representing Community Board 4, a customer of mine, a great guy, Bruce McCaffer, who heads real estate for WPP, I think you know Bruce, he lives in that neighborhood. He said, you know, I'd be interested in serving on the community board. I introduce him to Chris. He gets on the community board. I think he's been re-upped now at least four times. The difference in having one person on that community board who understands real estate, who understands sort of basic principles, numbers, et cetera, it's night and day. And I think as an industry, we need to get more involved at that level.
I completely agree, and I'll just say, I think it's just generally even more so, any level of civic engagement is critical. You know, when I go to projects or town hall board meetings or city council meetings to get things approved, the people that show up are the people that are against it from an ideological perspective, that haven't done the homework. So, and no one who's actually done the homework or is thinking long term is there to provide the counterpoint. So if you're an elected official, that's all you hear. And in a world where people are making decisions on headlines or 250 whatever character tweets, that's a problem. And you know, I like to always quote Louis Brandeis, who said, the most important political office is that of private citizen. And I think that if we all don't realize that we all have a civic responsibility to be educated, to communicate, to be active, to have our voices heard, then the mobs, and which generally, by the way, is the minority view, but they're the passionate minority view, are ultimately going to rule what happens, and we're going to pay the consequences, and our children are going to pay the consequences for that.
Can I say something that I just saw recently that showed me it can work, how government can work with real estate? So Charlie Bendit, one of the Taconic partners, took me on a tour of Essex Crossing. Have you been there yet? Everybody has to go, okay? And the thing that struck me about it is that, by the way, 75 years of rubble was there while the community duked it out over what they wanted. In the Bloomberg administration, economic development, and I'm going to give a shout out to Miriam Harris, who was working at EDC at the time. She's with Trinity Holdings now.
Seth Pinsky.
And Seth Pinsky, exactly right. Your guy.
My guy. I got him a shout out there.
So Seth, Miriam, they came up with this brilliant idea. You know, the community is like, again, they're fighting like left and right. They said, wait a minute, we're going to give you money to hire an urban planner and an architect to advise you. Is it that time? Okay. To advise you. Bottom line is, community comes up with a list of 14 things they want. They issue it in the RFP. Every developer gets to pitch against those 14 things. Taconic and their partners, a number of other colleagues, another partners of theirs, they give them all 14, but the city's willing to accept less money in order to get all 14 things of the community. Guess what? The thing is rolling out like the success you would hope that it would be. I'm sorry to run over time.
So thank you for lunch, Miriam.
Oh, thank you so much.
Yeah. I'm full. Thank you, everyone.